The U.S. Senate spent all night and all day today debating the nomination of Judge Neil Gorsuch to be the next Associate Justice of the Supreme Court. Lawmakers took turns trading barbs and discussing the so-called nuclear option, which could change long-standing Senate rules so that confirmation requires only a majority vote instead of the usual 60.
Judge Gorsuch, to me, is not mainstream. You'll put corporate interests above individual interests. So for all those reasons, it seems appropriate to me that this is why we have a 60-vote threshold, to make sure we don't take extreme nominees and allow them to be confirmed by a partisan vote.
Every excuse they've come up with to engage in this unprecedented filibuster is completely without merit. What they're really upset about is what happened on November the 8th. And I don't believe if they won't confirm Judge Gorsuch, they will never vote to confirm any nominee of this president, period.
Invoking the nuclear option is a dangerous path to go down. Mr. President, I've been in the majority, I've been in the minority. And either way, I believe when it comes to a lifetime appointment to the Supreme Court, the Senate must adhere to a higher standard and the 60-vote threshold. If you can't get that many votes for a Supreme Court nominee, you don't need to change the rules, you need to change the nominee.
I'm left with no choice. I will vote to change the rules and allow Judge Gorsuch to be confirmed by a simple majority. I will do so with great reluctance, not because I have any doubts that Judge Gorsuch will be an excellent justice, but because of the further and perhaps irreparable damage that it will do to the United States Senate.
For more now on the continuing fight over the Supreme Court nominee, the negotiations between the White House and Congress to repeal and replace Obamacare, and President Trump's effort to roll back parts of the Obama legacy, we turn to Matt Schlapp. He's chairman of the American Conservative Union. We had hoped to have Karine Jean-Pierre, she's a senior advisor for MoveOn.org, join us as well, but she is stuck in traffic here in Washington. She may join us in progress, but meantime, Matt, you and I are going to have this conversation. So what do you make of the determination now of Democrats that they're going to be at least three of them who vote for Neil Gorsuch, but not enough to give him the 60 that he would need?
You know, what I'm struck with, obviously I'm a partisan, I'm a Republican, but what I'm struck with is that Neil Gorsuch really passed all the gates. He seemed very steady during his hearings, really didn't have a misanswer throughout all of that process. Has a stellar record, but it just shows you in our hyper-partisan age, it's very hard anymore to get these crossover votes for Supreme Court nominees, especially because the court has kind of inserted itself in every major question in society, and they are a flashpoint.
Of course, the Democrats would say, well, he didn't answer as many questions as we would have liked.
But they all admitted that he did a good job. They would have liked him to step in something, and he really did avoid that.
Is there anything else either the White House, President Trump, or Judge Gorsuch could have done, do you think, to get Democrats to 60? Or do you think this was cooked coming in because of what happened last year?
I think Democrats are very upset at the treatment of Merrick Garland. They thought he deserved to have a vote, a hearing, and a vote. And of course, Republicans saw this Supreme Court opening, this kind of really important swing pick, just too close to the election, and they wanted to wait. But I do think Republicans could cut a deal. The president could cut some kind of a deal to get enough Democrats to come over.
What do you mean?
Well, he'd have to cut some deal on future Supreme Court picks, maybe watering down the types of picks he'd like to make. And I think for Republicans, that's just anathema. They think that Neil Gorsuch deserves an up or down vote.
You mean the Democrats would, in essence, take his word that he was going to follow up with a more moderate choice than
next time? That's right. And I think for Republicans and for conservatives, that's a bridge too far. They believe they won this election. They've picked a nominee who has gotten huge majorities in the Senate previously, who's well qualified by the American Bar Association. So they really felt like they put a nominee up that deserves an up or down vote.
All right, let's turn to health care. We keep seeing that the White House is trying to get something resurrected with House Republicans that will effectively repeal and replace Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act. But they're struggling, and we saw just this afternoon, Speaker Ryan was seen going into the White House again. Where does that stand, and what do you see the prospect?
Well, I've had conversations with the Speaker and with the White House, and they are trying very hard to get to a bill. You know, just like in every political party, we have our hardcore conservatives and we have our more moderate members that come from more swing districts, and they're trying to strike a balance to get to the 218, and they're simply not there. I think where they want to go on the bill is to allow more state opt-outs of the Obama mandates, and they're trying to figure out if they can get to that 218.
All right, Karine Jean-Pierre has joined us. We're so sorry you were stuck in
Washington.
That's okay. Do we need an infrastructure bill?
That's a whole different subject. We're not going to talk about that right now. Next time. But Karine, on this question of the Republicans still trying really hard to come up with something where they can get enough votes to repeal and replace Obamacare, is this something that Democrats are prepared to work with the White House?
No, the only way that would happen is if Republicans said, hey, you know what? We know Obamacare is a place to start and there are some fixes. Both sides have said that Obamacare needs some fixes. If they were to come to Democrats and say, let's fix Obamacare, but if it's repeal and replace, I don't see that happening. And the thing, too, you would think that Republicans would have learned from their mistake, which was they try to jam down this Trump care in 17 days. And now to come back and say, hey, you know, we're going to introduce something that is not on paper, and by the end of the week, pass it or vote on it, which we know that's no longer going to happen. That's also, they haven't learned their lesson. Obama took 13 months to push ACA in a public way.
Right.
And it was very difficult for him to do that.
Any way to make this work with Democratic support?
I think you make very fair points. I don't think the Democrats are going to solve the Republicans' problem. I think this is a problem that Republicans need to solve.
Well, speaking of rolling back Obamacare, there are a number of other things to both of you that this president is saying is signaling and moving on to roll back, from the environment, labor rules, internet privacy. You go down the list. There are several, it seems, that emerge every single day. Matt Schlapp, is this designed? We know the president does believe in doing this, but is this designed to shore up the base? Is it designed to win over people in the middle? I mean, how do you see the political calculus?
You know, I looked over this list, executive orders and congressional review acts, and I think, by and large, there are two themes of the Trump presidency, economic growth and security. And I think most of these issues involve that. I think Donald Trump understands if the economy doesn't get growing and we don't start adding jobs and people don't start feeling better about their take-home pay and their economic situation, his political standing will be harmed by that. And I think they want to take everything they can off the ability of business people, of entrepreneurs, to invest and grow their companies.
And we have seen, Karine, in the last weeks, that his approval rating in so many of the national polls has been sliding. In some, it's down in the 30s.
Yeah.
Who knows, you know, how long lasting that is. But how do you see this? Is this something, if he's able to do what Matt says, can he win support?
But the problem is, Judy, is he's rolling back issues, policies that are actually very popular. And we have to remember, Donald Trump didn't win with the popular vote. He doesn't have a mandate. Only 26-27% of eligible voters actually voted for Donald Trump. And it's troubling to see what he's doing. And there are people on your side who are very concerned by some of the rollbacks that he's doing, especially when it comes to privacy. And so it's certainly a problem that we should be concerned about. And so I don't see how this is going to be popular. It certainly doesn't show that he's a president for everyone. It's just him tripling down on his base.
Can I simply say on these congressional review acts, mm-hmm. of which we've only seen one in our history, and to see over a dozen come to the president's desk, there's just a lot of action here. And I think for him politically, one of the downsides for him is there's so much action. But also one of the upsides is that we're not focusing on one because there's so many.
But also for some of these, it may be folks who like him, but there are also folks who don't like him.
Sure.
When he stirs
all the pot. Matters for President Trump is he's got to get that economy humming. If he doesn't, there's consequences.
The funny thing is his favorite poll, Rasmussen, even shows him down by 16 points at 43.
I don't think it's his favorite poll.
Well, that's what he keeps focusing on. So there's a problem there. His numbers are softening.
All right. Well, we're glad the infrastructure helped get you here today. Karine,
thank you so much, Judy, and I'm so sorry about that.
It's all right. Matt Schlapp, thank you both.
You know, if we drain the swamp, we'll have less traffic.
Oh, is that right? It is. That's the problem.